Welcome, Peter.
Thank you. Thank you, Werner. And thank you for actually giving me the opportunity to talk here. I'm really excited. This may look like a calm environment, but I'm very excited, even though I try to look calm. I'm very happy to share with you some insight from a project that we've been developing at the Association of Danish Architectural Firms, documenting how architecture creates value. This might be evident for most of us in this room, but it's actually not necessarily evident to a lot of the people that we actually work for, clients or society at large. So what is it worth is really the question that we keep encountering, talking to commercial developers, or these steering committees that are the clients of today's construction industry and the value chain that we work with as architects. What is it worth? Who has it? Can it be sold hat on? Implying that that's not the architect, of course. So when we propose a green roof, you know, is it a wacky idea or does it create value or who thinks of the parking, you know? Those are the kinds of understandings of the work of architects that we sometimes encounter. But we've actually been testing the idea of what is the value of a green roof. This is the Moskau Museum in outside Aarhus in Denmark. It's an archaeological museum with a display of anthropology items. And Henning Larsen designed this beautiful museum. And as you can see, there's a strategy of sort of peeking under the lid of the roof, you know, digging into the ground. You know, some of the things on display here are the people that they found in Danish bogs, you know, mummies. So it's a metaphor of this process, but it's also a way of drawing in daylight and making these cuts in the buildings. And it's an energy efficiency measure, and it's also a climatic design, which is protecting the exhibits from the direct sun, but giving a great dynamic environment on the inside of this building. So I'm going to be hugely reductive here and reduce the value of this to a number. 7. This is the increase in visitors to the museum that they experienced after moving in. And you can ask yourself, you know, what does that, you know, well, I mean, that's nice, of course, but what does it really, you know, what does it signify? You know, this is becoming a measure of an increased interest in the culture of and the history of this place. It's also, you know, the business proposal of this museum. Of course, they're interested in visitors. But this has also had, you know, effects on the entire tourism in the city of Aarhus, where they can see a significant increase because this has become a major destination, you know, that to supplement the Aarhus Museum that Marianne just showed. So this number actually has, you know, meanings in many other dimensions than the economy of visitors and the money that they bring to this place. I think it's really interesting that the word value, you know, has two meanings. It's a question of, you know, what makes sense to us, you know, what creates value for our being, you know, can we how do we interpret things? I mean, do they mean something to us? Are they meaningful? Do we desire it? And value is also the process of measuring up, you know, how does it actually perform? How is it, you know, relative to something else? That's applying value and measuring things. So we have this range of measurement and meaning when we discuss value, and it has many dimensions, many spheres. So I'm going to show you some of the cases. And we're trying to document or find, you know, documentation for these for these projects, and it's been difficult because basically there's very little interest in doing post-occupancy evaluations, so we don't have that many facts on how the built environment actually performs, at least not on a base case way. In Denmark, there's been a recent investment in hospitals, and this is a psychiatric ward that's designed by academic architects. One of the problems in psychiatry in Denmark has been that there's been a high use of force when you deal with very sick people. This is, of course, a great problem, particularly for the people that are sick, but it's also a problem for the people that has to apply the force. So the intention has been to reduce force, and part of the strategy has been to develop these new environments where you have a focus on daylight, on access to nature, on transparency, and improving the orientation within the building so that you can actually figure out, you know, what is happening and intervene before crises and conflicts erupt. These buildings are also designed so as to stimulate movement and to facilitate movement as part of the therapy. And we found it really interesting that the statistics, and these are very primary statistics, show that they have been able to reduce forced fixation by 69% comparing to 1 month after they moved in to the same month before they moved. And it's, of course, not something created by the architects, but the doctors do point to that the architecture and the design has a significant impact on this result. And it's also underline that this value is created not by the architects, but the entire community and the dialogue of, you know, decision-making that goes into creating a place like this. So a lot of actors are involved, and and it's really the dialogue process that is one of the main keys to achieving these. It's not a lone result in Open Road by Wired Architects. They have not the same, you know, drastic reduction, but there's another reduction which I find really significant, which is that the work accidents has been reduced. And that's, of course, what happens when you don't have to apply force. The same, the design is entirely different aesthetically, but it follows the same principles. So, looking at architecture in this way, you can actually say that there's actually sort of an inherent business model behind it that is not necessarily explicit. You know, we don't necessarily think of business models, or as architects, we don't think of our buildings as business models. The developers do, of course. But the whole thing is still a question of trying to create some benefits and reduce the costs. And these, again, come in different dimensions. So you can talk about capitals in different spheres, environmental, social, and economic. And what happens, you know, is that you transfer something from one sphere to the other. So when you build, you dig things up from the ground, you process these into materials and building components, and obviously that has costs on the environment. You may also have social costs like work accidents, and of course there's an economic cost. You want to reduce that, and you want to apply the process of fabrication so seamlessly as possible so that you can minimize the costs. But the realm of benefits, that is really what is happening, you know, what is happening by the design, through the dialogue. And again, the benefits come in different dimensions. Another case here is a sports hall by Vandkunsten. It's built on prefabricated timber elements. You see that this is an completely open, dynamic environment. There's no installations apart from the very raw lining here. So this changes with the day and the season, and in this way, the design strategy here eliminates the need for heating and cooling because it challenges the idea of what is a sports facility. Well, I mean, people are in motion, so you can perfectly well do that without heating, and in this way, they reduce the cost by 80% in the life cycle costing. And this building is actually carbon neutral. So you can say that you actually sort of reduce the environmental dimension, cost dimension, entirely measured on climate impacts. And you and the economic cost is also reduced drastically, simply because you challenge the idea of what is a sports facility. We have densification of the major cities in Denmark. The unused attic areas are so attractive because of the economic value of access to daylight, which you have on the rooftops. So actually, when you do new rooftop apartments, they are able to pay for an entire energy retrofit of the building. I think that's a very good and effective way forward with the urban transformation that we're going through. 2 years ago, I think Christopher and I had asked, you know, how do we get people outside? And I'm happy to see, you know, your results on that being developed further. In Denmark, Copenhagen, all the cities, there's been a major investment in improving the urban quality by cleaning up the environment. This used to be a traffic corridor, now it's an urban park. And similar things have happened on the harbor fronts. And now we're going through climate mitigation things that actually have very, very low costs. But but this one actually produced so much value in increased urban activity and commercial activity, so that this investment was actually paid back in one and a half years. So it's by looking at the value, it really creates a lot, and it's. And you can actually measure that. The Rambøll headquarters here, very well documented technically, DGNB certified building. But what is really interesting is that after moving into this urban urban landscape, which is the heart of the building, people began working more together, and you can see an increase in the internal sales of this corporation. So I think that this is really the question of when we build, we usually think of reducing costs and also the operation of buildings. But what we really should be looking at is what is the value that produced. This is a difficult proposition actually, because it's not necessarily the same people that pay for the construction of the building that actually use the building. We see increasingly a separation of these actors, and it's very hard to actually sell, you know, the superior quality of the design to maybe unknown user organization. But this is nevertheless what we need to quantify and estimate. Here. What I think is really interesting here is that this is a gearbox. If you can improve the performance in the design phase, these effects may carry over to the entire, you know, operation of the building and the value it will produce over the entire life cycle of its urban life. We have a case that is education facility for adults. These are people who are have been unemployed for some time, and they need to have further education so that they can go on and get a job. That's basically the purpose of this adult education center. One of the problems is that these people don't necessarily have had a good idea of or a good experience of going to school. So one of the main things in the client's program was here, this must not look like a school. So this is really open urban plaza in several levels, and you can sort of spiral your way up through the central atrium. And this has been tested out in primary schools and so on, but this, here they actually did a social post-occupancy study. And they figure out that people were very satisfied with the study environment, and that they found that this building stimulated them to meet up, you know, do their studies, and basically work. So they found out that this really, if you compare that with the statistics, they could figure out that they had such an increase in the turnover of students that which grew by 400 people a year. And since each person, you know, going from unemployment to further studies, and perhaps some of them get a job, if only a third of them get a job after continuing an education, well, this building would be paid back in 3 years. And it's a big one, you know. So what we see as a need, really, is an increased... we really need to know more about how buildings perform. We need to do more post-occupancy studies. But of course, we also need to be better at estimating, you know, how do they perform, and bring that knowledge to the very beginning of the process where we begin to develop the performance indicators with the client. And dialogue is really of the essence here, and so are all the metrics and the tools that I find you developing and applying and using in this community that we're creating in this in this space and these series of symposium. So these are the tools that we are looking for and developing as you know, to as the business strategy for the architectural firms. And I'm really, really happy to see so much happening in this space and to produce these ideas. So you can find more information on our website. Unfortunately, it's only in Danish, but we'll work on an English translation very soon. Thank you very much.